That's probably not this evening, then.
Yeah, I would hope not, unless something happened drastically in the last half hour.
So we're going to go through a brief introduction. We'll review the auditor's reports for the year ended December 31st of 19. A little analysis of the 2019 highlights and trends. We'll review the federal programs that were tested, some internal control and compliance findings, and then some communications. Brief introduction. This is my opportunity as an auditor to remind you what our responsibilities are. So we audit under three accounting standards. I apologize. The first, generally accepted auditing standards. This is the financial audit, where we test the actual financial statement to make sure it's materially correct. The second is government auditing standards, and this is the review of internal controls over financial reporting. And the third is uniform grant guidance. This is the single audit, or this is also our testing of the federal programs, major federal programs this year for the city. And our responsibility as auditors to give you two opinions. The first opinion is on the financial statements themselves to make sure that they are materially correct with generally accepted accounting principles. And the second is an opinion on the city's compliance with internal controls and compliance with the federal program that we tested. And this year we tested the PennVest program, which is the loans being used for the sewer treatment plant, and also the Section 108 loans outstanding, which have some continuing disclosure compliance that we looked at. Also a reminder, so the reporting entity for the city includes the following components. So we have a blended component unit in the Reading Area Water Authority. What that means is that the Reading Area Water Authority is audited by a separate auditor. We take their report and it actually gets blended right into the water fund of the city. And you'll see that it's actually a consolidating schedule in the back of the financial statement. But since it's so interrelated with the city operations, the water fund is blended right in. The Redevelopment Authority and the Parking Authority were to consider discreetly presented component units. They're included within the statement, but they're not blended into the operation. Just a quick update on both of those component units for you. The Reading Redevelopment Authority audit was completed and was issued last month in October. I know there's been a lot of discussions with council and Redevelopment Authority for moving forward. We did have some really good discussion with the Redevelopment Authority, especially about their current staffing situation and their progress looking forward. So I'm glad to see those conversations taking place with council. The second, the Reading Parking Authority, that audit is in draft form, went out to the board members today and will be presented at their board meeting tomorrow night. Two really quick things on the Parking Authority that I think it's important for council to know. One, significant improvement in our financial reporting this year. We actually are going to have no internal control related deficiencies at the Parking Authority within their report. So I'm excited about that. It's the first time we've had that since 2015. So a lot of work was done by the finance and the administration team there. And that'll be talked about more in detail tomorrow night then with the board. And secondly is the delay, a little bit of a delay there getting the Parking Authority done. They were hit pretty hard on the COVID side too. A lot of office staff out transitioning one to the other. So still were able to get that report out the door in time here to meet the city's deadlines so that we were able to issue the city report then on Monday. We do include the work of specialists, so the actuarial analysis for the pension liability and for the other post-employment benefit liability, mostly health insurance after retirement, is done by Conrad Siegel, and an indirect cost allocation done by a company called Maximus. And we have unmodified opinion, so clean audit opinion on both generally accepted auditing standards and a uniform grant guidance, a modified opinion, clean audit opinion from us as an independent auditor. Just a reminder, we don't do an internal control audit, so this is a financial and compliance audit. I always like to remind everybody of that just to make sure we're on the same page. But our responsibility to give those two opinions and both unmodified clean audit opinions for the city. Tried to make this a little bit larger to follow here, so hopefully everybody can see this. But this is a three-year analysis and then the budget on the right-hand side for 2019. So a couple of just general highlights from the 2019 year. The first orange bar on the right-hand side will show the budgeted revenues of $77,138,906. Actual revenues were $78,078,141. So revenue was over budget by a little over 1.2%. Slightly stronger real estate tax collections, offset a little bit by earned income tax being slightly below budget, and in real estate transfer tax, which is included in the other taxes, bringing up the revenue side. Nothing large, nothing unusual, just some small overall variances. The expenditures, which will be the second orange bar, the last column on the right shows you your budgeted expenditures, $92,248,178. Expended during 2019 was $88,081,805, or about 4.5% below budget. We're going to talk a little bit more on the next slide that breaks this down in a nice chart, but positive variance and fringe benefits. So health insurance, about $1.8 million below budget on health insurance in 2019. And then public works, still favorable variance there. Part of that is just projects that didn't quite get off the ground in 19. We kind of talked about this when we were doing our audit closing meeting from 18, which happened to be in early 2020. So I'm glad to be talking to you twice in 2020 this year, getting back on track. But we knew that this was an issue. The city has addressed this by bringing in a capital project manager. So not something that was surprising, but it is something that we did notice. The last item to point out on this schedule is second green bar from the bottom. You'll see a $2 million transfer out and no budgeted amounts. This is transferring $2 million of assigned fund balance that were already assigned actually from 2017's surplus. $1 million was the OPEB trust that was transferred over to fund that. And the second was another $1 million for a capital projects transfer over. So that was not current operations. However, the third number from the bottom, or the last green bar, you'll see $2,003,000 negative under budget. Right next to that, you'll see a positive $1,072,336. That is the current year surplus for the city and the general fund, bringing fund balance up to $32,531,430. And again, just to give a little bit more of a summarized version, I took the material variances then between budget to actual. So you can see here, again, real estate taxes, $450,000 over our budget, earned income tax about $250,000 under. Other taxes, which would really include the transfer tax, of about $815,000 over our budget. Public works, $1.4 million. That's some streetlight in there also, and projects that didn't take place. $1.8 million in fringe benefits, and then a $2 million transfer of prior year fund balance. You'll see this comes up to $2.3 million. The bottom orange bar there will show $3.3 million. That's the variance, the positive variance. The other $1 million is just small supplies and other items throughout the different accounts. Nothing big and material. And it's actually less than, or it's about 1.1% of your budgeted expenditures. One thing I do want to point out is on the bottom left, it shows on the financial statement, you'll see the $1,072,000 surplus in 2019. However, just a function of accounting, the transfer to Fund 44 and the transfer to the OPEB trust fund come out as expenses. So the true operating surplus in 19 was $3,072,336. So I think that's just important when you're looking at operations to know $2 million that actually came from the prior year. Okay, Jamar.
Can I, thank you, Chris. Sorry. Oof. I think this is a good time to mention to council that at the beginning of the year, council approved transferring $1.5 million of 2019 fund balance into street paving. And I'm currently working with the law department to make a recommendation that that ordinance be rescinded so that we can maintain the general fund surplus for 2019, as you see listed here. And that'll be coming within the next week or two. That's all, thank you.
I'm going to move past just some quick trends just to show you breakdown in general fund revenues and expenditures. 32% of total revenues do come from real estate taxes, while 28% on the top left here do come from earned income tax. And on the general fund expenditures, the top right just shows 64% of your expenditures do go to public safety, which is quite typical when you have full-time public safety between police, fire, and EMS. So lastly, to point out for the general fund, this is your 2018-19 balance sheet, so to speak. So the bottom right-hand side, I will see the same total fund balance, $32,531,000. Of that, $30,231,000 is unassigned. There are still some assignments left over from the prior year. And $300,000 of budget appropriations. So that is what you use to budget, balance the budget in 2020. And just in a graphical form, to kind of show a little history here, going back to 2011, the dotted line represents your minimum fund balance policy. So your minimum fund balance policy is that $22 million of unassigned fund balance. And you can see from 2015, kind of crossed that threshold and have been increasing since then. The dark blue, the 32,531, represents the total fund balance in the general fund. The light blue, 30,231, represents your unassigned reserve. So well in excess of that $22 million, and put yourselves in a good position, especially going into 2020, with everything that has taken place, was able to weather the storm, you know, better than you would have been in the past, when we have this reserve that we did not have before. So definitely a positive reserve here, $30,231,430, and again in excess of your budgeted, your capital policy of $22 million, budget policy of $22 million. That's all I have on the general fund. Quick hit on the other governmental funds. Two things to point out here. Well, three, I guess. One, grant fund. Grant's the old agency fund. So agency became a different buzzword in the accounting world. So we recommended a change to grant funds. It's really what it is. That's what's holding the grants. Internal purposes doesn't change. It's just the external reporting. So if you're curious why it says grant and not agency, now you know. But the last two columns, liquid fuels and capital projects. If you come down to the bottom, we'll see the fund balance in liquid fuels at the end of 19 was a little over $6.2 million, and capital projects was almost $16 million. So when we talk about the moving forward with the capital projects manager that you brought on board, trying to move along the capital, and especially street paving. Now, I know that for liquid fuels, this was the end of 19, and in 20, there was a lot of street paving that was taking place. So I was really encouraged to see starting to spend that liquid fuels money. Taking in about $2.3 million a year, only spending $390,000. It was good to see that paving was actually taking place and we were improving the streets. Move to our enterprise fund. So the water fund, again, this does include Rahwa. In 2019, I'm going to come down on the right-hand side, the third orange bar from the bottom will show a positive $336,647. It's also noted in the paragraph off to the right. And that consists of a $598 surplus from Rahwa and a deficit of $261 from the City Water Fund. That deficit is just generated by depreciation. That's not a concern. It's just a function of depreciating the assets down. But we did have a $336,000 surplus within the Water Fund this year. One thing to keep in mind here, the Birdsboro Power Plant would have just come on board right at the end of 2019. So we'll start seeing some of that additional surplus coming in 2020. And you'll see that flowing through then the lease payments also back to the city. But the water fund does end with a net position of $19,721,000. And of that, $15,319,000 is unrestricted. Moving on to the sewer fund, third orange bar from the bottom again will show a change in net position of $17,769,430. So that was your surplus in the sewer funds this year, a little less than $18 million. That brings the net position of the sewer fund up to $176,804,656, of which $134,554 is unrestricted in that fund. So healthy sewer fund. Also starting to see that construction starting to come to an end. And I know that one discussion we've had with administration a little bit and actually came up during the audit committee meeting on November 5th was where the new IMAs were and working through that process now that the sewer plant is getting pretty close to completion. And the last enterprise fund, solid waste. So this is trash and recycling. Mixed it up a little bit. We're going to go to the second green bar this time on the schedule. And we'll see a positive change in net position, a surplus of $1,522,873 within solid waste. About 400,000 of that is about four lines above that intergovernmental revenue. This is a recycling grant that came through. This is an equipment recycling grant for the city. It was actually reimbursing some expenses that happened in a prior year. There were some recycling bins that were purchased through this grant process. The state's always a little bit behind on getting recycling grants out to the cities and the municipalities. So about 420,000 of that surplus did come from a recycling grant. But that does bring the net position in that fund to $4,689,176, of which $4.2 million is unrestricted. So continuing to be in a healthy position here in our solid waste fund also. So overall, as we've gone through general fund, the other capital, the other governmental funds, and then into the enterprise funds, you know, all good news for the financials for the city for 2019. Continuing to be strong in all of those funds. And one thing encouraging, although I'd like to see, and we're going to see more spending on the capital side, is that the city has been able to generate more capital projects funds to do more capital purchases than you have in a long time. And it's nice to be able to see you moving forward in that respect. Brief stop at the statement of net position. So this is your full accrual balance sheet. What that means is it puts all your fixed assets. It also puts your debt on here, including the two green bars. The two green bars represent the net pension liability and any other post-employment benefits liability for the city. Those two liabilities and those green lines combined for $156,902,000 of liability. And brings your net position down to $59,918,134.
Okay. So the first number is 301,715,8592. No problem. That goes through.
And lastly, looking at the pension plan activity, just to show it was a good year in 12/31/19. This is as of the end of 12/31/19. So the O&E pension, 82% funded, fire at 78, and police at 62, getting above that 60% threshold, which is important in the world of pension funding. One other thing to mention here, you may have thought that 2020 has been a bouncing around year, and it has been. But on the positive side, I believe I saw the stock market hit some of the all-time highs today after some vaccine positive news. So hopefully our pensions continue to be really well-funded after 2020. And some key report footnotes. I know everybody's always interested in the footnotes of the report, so if you're ever interested in doing some reading. I will say, for anybody who's newer to council or wants to learn a bit of, about more, Note 11 and 12 give a lot of information on the city pension plans, and also the other post-employment, the retirement benefits for health insurance for retirees. It gives a nice summary of who's eligible for what and when those different timelines start based upon when you're hired. So there is some good information in those two notes. And management's discussion and analysis that is also included in the financial statement. Jamar, Michael, and his team did a nice job, but have a nice write-up there too. All right, we're going to get out of financials here for a minute. We'll get to our audit summary page. So here we'll see the two unmodified. So again, two clean audit opinions. But we will see some yeses here for some internal control reporting findings, and we're going to get to those right now. So here's my takeaway for you. The total number of internal control and compliance-related findings decreased to 5. Now, 5 may still sound like a large number, but it's been 8 for the last 3 years, and it was 11 the year before that. So making significant progress. The preparation of the schedule of expenditures of federal awards was not a finding for the first time since before 2011. And I know when we had the audit committee meeting, Marcia was talking about this a little bit. And you know, it's nice to see that the city getting control of that schedule. And this is what lays out all of the federal awards that the city has received and how they've expended them and what's remaining at the end of the year. Proposed adjustments declined significantly. We were about half of the amount of proposed adjustments that we were last year. So reconciling accounts, reconciling them timely, continued improvement. And that goes to the continued improvement, the timeliness and accuracy of the reporting. And we did this audit 100% remotely. So real kudos, so to speak, here to the finance team. They did a great job of keeping things organized for us. We had a lot of Zoom meetings, staying in touch. But it was a great partnership to get through this audit and to still come out here in the fall and get this presented. Before we get into findings, just a quick summary here of our federal revenues. You'll see in 2019, total federal awards on the bottom right, $36,390,000, down from $60 million in the prior year, but that's expected as the capitalization grants, that's PennVest, declines as we're getting close to the completion of the sewer plant. So that makes sense to us. It's what we would expect, and that's where the drop in curve. So here's our summary of the five findings here for 2019. Account reconciliations, material adjustments, material weakness. So we still have some work to do on the adjustment side. In particular, PennVest accounting is still a little bit of a challenge. Gets a little more complexity splitting it between the two, where you have solid waste, you have liquids, keeping up with reconciling. And we're going to see that again in the grant reporting side. Another challenge, self-insurance. So the city self-insured for liability insurance and workers' comp. That fund was not updated, and we had to assist in just getting that fund accruals updated at the end of the year. But what I will say is that not all findings are created equally, and we do continue to see a lot of improvement here with account reconciliations and adjustments. Pension reporting, we've talked pension reporting every year, and pension reporting is one of those items where it's like continual improvement is what I will say pension reporting is. Part of it is the conversation between ADP and pensionable wages to make sure that we are coding things properly in the ADP system. There's a lot of different wages that go through, whether it's retro overtime, and based on starting dates, what's pensionable, what's not pensionable, different codes within ADP. And it's just important that payroll and pension continue to talk to make sure that we know what's pensionable wages and what's not. And the other side of that is the AG 385. That's the annual report that is used for then the units to get your pension aid in the next year. So it's important that that report is accurate to make sure we get the right amount of pension aid back with the number of units for public safety and for non-uniformed employees. Coming a long way, I think sometimes pension office gets a little lost in the mix. It's not quite in the finance office. It kind of sits by itself. I know that Jamar and his team have been really trying to help out a little bit more. And I know Maria, you've gotten involved on the pension side also. So good to see. Just always a reminder that the pension office is just a really important office here at the city. The underpayment of the MMO in 2019, part of this was the handoff from different controllers in the city too. Part of this was 2019 MMO had to be revised at one point. And the original math, so the city pays the MMO monthly, and the math was done off the budgeted amount, which did not match the MMO amount. So when it was paid in, it got paid in 12 installments, but it just did not meet the minimum municipal obligation. It was only by about $50,000, so not a large dollar amount, but something that's easily correctable, and I personally would like to not see there again. And I know working with the administration, Michael and his staff and Jamar have already taken a look at 2020 to make sure that we're on track. This won't be a finding again. Indirect costs, I'm hoping this is the last year we have indirect costs as a finding. So indirect costs study was not performed since 2015 for the city. And as Marcia knows, dealing with federal programs, the indirect costs report becomes a pretty vital avenue because if HUD, the Department of Housing and Urban Development, come in and audit the city, do a monitoring, and they want to know you charged X amount of money to indirect costs, what's your substantiation for that? Well, we're still basing that off of a 2015 study. Now, the city does hedge it, so you only charge about half. And Jamar's got the updated study there in his hands. So we don't have a problem from a community development standpoint, and I think you're overcharging the program. But at the same token, this is something that should be done annually, and I know that the city's working to catch up and moving forward there. And I know the contract is already in place to get you up to speed there.
Excuse me, Chris. I just want to say that the 2019 MMO was never reviewed by the city auditor, and the administration never presented to me. Maria, can you repeat that? I didn't hear that.
Yeah, I
just want to say that the 2019 MMO calculation was never reviewed by the city auditor.
I think Chris alluded to turnover in staffing, and we've since corrected that and are in close communication with the auditor's office on these matters.
Thanks, guys. The last item here is just grant reporting, and this goes back to PennVest. Large grant, a lot of complexities, making sure that we are actually reconciling that any cost that incurred for the capitalization of the sewer plant is being run through the PennVest loans to make sure we're taking advantage, the city's taking advantage of these low-income loans. What we were finding is that there wasn't a reconciliation being done to make sure that all of the payments being made through this project were actually being drawn down, and that reconciliation to make sure we were complete. And there wasn't necessarily a great oversight of that individual who was performing these tasks. So that has since been corrected. I know that this has been an ongoing process. That position also did turn over. We have to put our time travel hat and go back a step here, but our sewer accountant, so to speak here, did turn over during, I believe, 2018 into 19. But that is a complex program, and I know that Jamar and Michael have paid a lot more attention to that now, and that's going to be something that's definitely full front on the radar as this report is starting to come to an end for the sewer plant construction. Mm-hmm. So quick findings history. So the orange represents the repeat findings. The blue is what was removed this year, and I'm happy to report no green. So no new findings in 2019. And again, you know, we've been doing this for several years, and it's not often I get to tell you we didn't have any new findings this year. So it's exciting to actually see that movement forward. And again, I have a lot of, I mean, we look back at the history here and we see, I mean, you know, findings were 14, 13, 12, 8, 11, 8, 7, 8. So 5 is the lowest amount of findings that the city's had since 2011. And it just shows you the progress. And the other thing I want to say is, even of the 5, one of them is very easily correctable. And I know that, Jamar, we're not going to have an MMO finding this year. So...
No MMO finding this year, and no statement of elected officials finding this year.
Yes. And hopefully remove the indirect cost finding also. So if you look at the progress moving forward, all of those are positives. We did have a management layer discussion. So we had a pretty in-depth discussion in our audit committee meeting on the 5th. Talked about some sewer capital reserve accounting. That's Fund 12. So in the existing IMAs, the payments coming in from the municipalities gets diverted, some operational, some into capital, making sure that transfer over to the capital Fund 12 within the city, which is the sewer capital reserve fund, is being done timely. Capital asset disposals. We spoke to the controller about this, and he's already taken steps to contact each department to go through and really just kind of shake out and see what is on the capital asset listing that we actually still have and what's not. Just to put that into perspective, it's not that I'm worried as an auditor that there's items on there that are value over. I'm worried there's just fully depreciated items. Like we have, you know, 35 police cars. We actually only have 12 because we got rid of, or whatever they might be. But they're fully depreciated. They're older items that it just needs to be cleaned up. Liquid fuels use of funds report. Better communication between public works and the finance department when that report's being put together. There's certain coding, certain projects that take place that public works necessarily knows, but finance doesn't. So we just need to improve that communication. Unclaimed property reporting, making sure that report gets done timely. That's for old checks, stale checks, whether it be payroll, whether it be vendor checks. Pension refund calculations. I know this is something the auditor's office is usually pretty involved in, but it's just important. You know, with the retirees, there's so many different nuances in collective bargaining agreements. The more set of eyes on that, the better, to be sure we're being calculated properly. Community Development Office. So with the CARES Act, with additional monies coming through from COVID, I know the city has generated some new programs, whether it be grant programs or loan programs or different different reaching out to the community. Just making sure we understand all the back end side of that. Make sure we cross all the T's, dot all the I's, and make sure the internal controls over the compliance is taking place. A lot of these funds went through existing programs such as CDBG, such as ESG, and just received additional funding. It's just a matter of making sure that we're staying on top of those requirements so that when they do become an audit next year, we can just smoothly transition. The internal auditor activities. Happy to see that the internal auditor is much more involved. So in the past, the internal audit staff and the city auditor was more just day-to-day transactions, really just reviewing payroll, reviewing disbursements. I've had a lot of talks with Maria about different agencies and seen her involved and asking questions on if I want to audit this or I want to review this, what steps do you recommend, and kind of talking things through. So much more activity there, and hopefully the city's going to continue to get more bang for your buck, so to speak, in that office. And lastly, the ultimate goal here, we'll get to a point where we have an accounting manual and some cross training so that when we have this turnover is inevitable in some respects. And I was talking to the new accounting and treasury manager saying, wouldn't it be nice when you started your position if you were handed a position detail that said, here's what your responsibilities are and here's what you're supposed to do, as opposed to having to track down Jamar or Michael and try to figure out what do I need to do next or how do I do these things. And I know this is something that's already been in progress, but that's the ultimate goal, right? That's the ultimate goal, is to be able to have that there so that when you have the transition, the operation just moves along smoothly. So from a communication standpoint, no difficulty in performing the audit. Again, really thankful for the staff of the city helping us out doing this remotely. I feel a little withdrawn. I haven't been in City Hall very often this year, and usually roam in the halls more often. So it's been a little different. We do have a lot of key crucial estimates in here. The other post-employment benefit liability that does come from Karen Siegel, the actuary. The funding status from the retirement plans, again, from Karen Siegel. Allowance from doubtful accounts and loans. We have a lot of loans outstanding community development-wise, making sure we know what's going to be collectible, what's not. Capital asset lives and depreciation, and the liability for self-insurance related to workers' comp and general liability. Looking at those studies that come in from those insurance companies and making sure we know what the estimated liability or exposure might be for the city. Proposed adjustments, again, noted in several funds, but definitely decreased from the prior year, and no other reportable matters from us. Some upcoming pronouncements, not going to go through them in detail, but working with Jamar and his team, appreciate it. The first one won't really affect too much for next year, for December of 20, but leases is something we'll have to just take a look at with the city to make sure. Briefly, leases just says right now, if you are leasing property, you're leasing copiers, or you have a commitment that doesn't show up as a liability, it just shows up in a footnote in the back as an off-balance sheet type of activity. And this standard says, well, you actually have an asset for a copier, so to speak, and then a liability against that. So it's really just compiling any leases that are outstanding. You don't have a lot of property leases, so this isn't as crucial. I know when we had our audit committee meeting, Sandy, for instance, at the city, they have a lot of leases for DJ buildings and other things. So much more of a comprehensive standard for like the county than it may necessarily be for you here at the city. And that's all I have. Lastly, just a little bit about us and then contact information if you ever need to get a hold of me for anything. Any questions?
Any comments?
Johanny.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so thank you for the presentation. I learned so much. My question is related to like the areas that we need to improve. Do we have, I guess, the steps currently in place to make sure that departments are speaking to one another, that we're able to fix those items? And then who's responsible to making sure that those items get rectified?
Jamar, do you want to talk a little about the corrective action plan? Hold on.
I can share that draft once it's ready. It's currently being worked on.
So I can say, Johanna, generally, in speaking with Jamar and his team, because we had the conversation ahead of time, they recognize some of the challenges, especially on the pension side, and they've already been working with the pension office and trying to alleviate some of these things. I think the new director of HR would be helpful there too, just in the sense of oversight to make sure that we're getting pensionable wages and we're getting payroll all in the right spot. And I've also already been encouraged with the communication I've seen between Public Works and Finance too. I mean, this has been a work in progress. If some of you remember in the past, we've had findings with grants that came through Public Works that Finance had no idea even existed and had to kind of be dug out of financials. And we're not seeing that anymore. Ultimately, though, Johanny, from a corrective action standpoint, we as auditors will review next year to see if we've had improvements. And Marsha and her and Maria with the audit committee, we're going to continue to meet then to go over findings and the status of those findings. Does that sound correct to you ladies?
Yeah, I just wanted to add to that. That was one reason we established the finance committee, or I mean the audit committee, because we would have an opportunity not to wait till next year's audit, but to look at the ongoing progress. And I want to thank Maria for really being on top of everything, asking questions early on so that we were able to rectify. And I think the fact that we had the reduction in audit findings is an example of when you monitor things more closely, you're able to address and rectify the issues.
So if I could, we've been working on a manual for the accounting department since actually last year. And then COVID pandemic kind of got in the way, but we are still diligently working on that. Second, I would say in terms of communication, I don't think anybody on this call can say there's a shortage of communication from me. And certainly I would say our communication with the Public Works Department has improved 2,000% since Stan Rugas was brought on, not only as project manager, but promoted to deputy director. We're in constant contact, even sometimes 6:30 in the evening, he calls me. So there's no worries about, from my vantage, communication between finance and Public Works.
That's great to know. Thank you.
Lucine, did you have a question?
Not so much a question, Chris. Thanks. You know, the sewer fund was always something that I know as it's coming to an end, I question kind of what next. And you touched on that. I think what Jamar just spoke of is having, you know, the mayor's made it a priority to have these key positions filled and filled with individuals who are really, truly, you know, executing and adding value to, you know, what we're trying to do here with the city. And that's starting to really show. And that they're working together as a team, and that, you know, we get healthy reports like this one. But I think for me too, really being most cautious as possible, like you said, with CD, with the CARES Act and the new programs as we move through that, making sure that those internal controls are there, that's something that, you know, we just have to watch out for, that we couldn't have anticipated. But, you know, I think overall, you know, I'm pleased, you know, with what was presented. And I know that there's a solid team in place. You know, you talk about success in our transition of, you know, having that manual or cross training, but having a solid team in place to really, you know, get that moving forward is key. So I just want to acknowledge that and look forward to the future.
Chris, just want to tell you thank you for the effort and the work. I appreciate the, from the city staff standpoint, the ongoing reduction of findings. I think you're right. We usually, if we got rid of two, we added five every year. So it's good to see that, you know, we're going in the right direction. So just wanted to thank you for the report. And we'll look forward for that report to be guidance for us moving forward. We're going to be speaking with Gordon here in a few minutes. So it pathways right into a deeper discussion for us. So thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, everybody. Appreciate being here. Thank you for all the staff, Maria, for all your help, and Jamar and your team getting through
Chris.
Pandemic audit here. I appreciate it. And hopefully I'll see you all soon.
Thank you to you, Omega.
Thanks, Chris.
Marcia?
Okay, I'm sorry. I saw you back in. So our next part of the agenda is for the three-year review and expenditures with Gordon. Oh, there you are, Gordon.
I'm here. I just I lost the background because I don't have a nice office like Chris does. So my bedroom is not real well lit. So I don't think I was doing this from an attic somewhere. So give me 1 second to show you what we have.
I didn't mind your car, office, Gordon.
My what?
Your car.
Oh, my car. It's dark out there, man. I can't do that right now.
Yeah, can't see.
I do a lot of my calls from the car because I have two small kids. We're no respecters of space. So first off, let me just say, echo what others have said. Congratulations, a really nice work on cleaning up some of those findings. I usually talk with Chris Turtell a couple of times a year and ask him, okay, you know, what's reasonable to expect the city to get rid of? What's going to take some time? What in your opinion? I understand they're all findings, but like he said, not all are created equal. And a lot of the ones that were on the list of things that we were focused on for this year that sound like they're dealt with. 2010, the first audit that would have been the first audited year under Act 47, the city had 16 findings, and it dropped down to around 10 or so and kind of hovered there for the last 4 or 5 years. As Jeff mentioned, sometimes it would go up one or two. But five is definitely the lowest it's been, at least during the Act 47 era. It sounds like you have a chance to erase a couple more. And that's all excellent. So, congratulations. And again, thank you to Maria and Donna and Jamar. And I know he's not on the phone, at least I don't think he is, but Michael and everybody else. That's good news. So it does transition right into what we're talking about here, in terms of, how things look in the 2021 budget and how things look beyond that. So we have talked about multi-year projections over the years. There's one that's in the exit plan that now is, you know, kind of tremendously outdated because of COVID-19. And we've talked about the need to kind of look beyond the deadline for exiting Act 47. And this is a high level projection. It's not nearly as sophisticated or fancy as we normally do it, but I think it will be effective anyway. So let me take you from where the end of Chris's story and take you through what we see in the 2021 budget. So Chris had mentioned this number. This is your reserves, your fund balance coming out of 2019, $32.5 million. He explained a little bit the difference between assigned and unassigned, but we're lumping that all together. The city hasn't run a deficit as we would count it, because we back out some of those transfers, like the ones that he mentioned, where you're really just moving money around. I think since 2010 or maybe 11, it's been a long time. You've had surpluses every year. That streak will end this year, right? That's not going to happen. We've looked at the revenues and the expenses through September. You know, September was a good month for real estate tax. Was a mediocre month for earned income tax, was a bad month for health insurance, the very high spending on employee health insurance, your self-insured, so that will go up and down. And, you know, we don't count and project every single line in the budget, but we have a list of about 10 or 15 revenues and a little smaller than that on the expenditure side, and our projection still shows you finishing this year with somewhere around a $5 million deficit. Again, could be less than that if you have a bunch of lines that are small where you're not spending or anything or very little, you know, you could whittle that down. But you know, we've been kind of stuck on this $5 million number now for a while. So we'll continue. I don't know that we'll do any more of these updates because the next time we talk, the year may even be over. But we do expect we do expect some sort of deficit this year. You do have the fund balance for that, right? So this is the $32 million. If we just take the $5 million, it drops you down to 27, entering 2021. Again, the city has the $22 million minimum number. You're well above that. You know, 2019 was a better year than the city had budgeted, mostly for good reasons. You can see the budget had a $300,000. I'm sorry, that's this year's budget. The budget had a hole in it. You didn't end up using any of the reserves. So it's okay to use reserves this year, right? Lots of places are. It's a luxury that you have in terms of the size of your reserves that other communities don't. And as a result, Reading hasn't done furloughs or layoffs or some of those other things that other cities have done. So, you know, I'm not sure very much will change over the next 45 days. The only thing that will happen in the rest of the year is you have all your big debt payments. But even if we drop this number and say, okay, what if they get it to $4 million? It doesn't change the picture that much, right? So this yes here, this is does it comply with the city policy, which simply means are your reserves staying above $22 million? Okay. So that's 2019 into 2020. When we spoke, I guess it would have been in early October, about the 2021 budget, the deficit in the budget was about $3 million, right? And you carry your deficit on the revenue side. It appears as carryover from prior year. And over the last 40 days or so, you've had some good things and you've had some bad things. So on the good side, when we last spoke, your earned income tax was down about 18% through the pandemic. And we said that we only had one data point and we would get a couple more and we would revise that projection. And we've done that. It's now somewhere between 12 and 14%. So that's good, right? So that adds, and that's incorporated in the most recent version of the budget, at least that we've seen. So it adds about $1 million to your general fund. So that's good. That's good news. We will incidentally get one more data point. It will be a big month. You get your November revenues on December 1st or 2nd, depending on whether that's a weekday or not. And so it's possible that this could come down a little more, right? It could go from 14 to 12 or 12 to 11 or 11 to 10, and you still may get a little bit of help there. What Berks EIT told Maria Cantner in the kind of countywide meeting is they're seeing 10% countywide. Reading's going to do a little worse than that. You don't have the same population and demographics that, you know, Wyomissing and the other parts of the county do. But you're not doing tremendously worse than that, right? They're not at 10 and you're not at 20. They're at 10 and you're at 12 or, you know, somewhere between 12 and 14%. So that's good news. Some other adjustments that were not as good. The city, I think, wisely has reduced the projection for the business privilege tax for next year. Remember, the business privilege tax runs 1 year behind. So what you were paid this year was for last year's activity. What you'll be paid next year will be for this year's activity. So the pandemic doesn't hit this until, hopefully it's over by August of next year, but who knows? But there's a 1 year lag. The other thing that's happened is in going through the budget line by line, position by position, in detail, we found a number of things that needed to be added into the budget that I think were just left out accidentally, right? So some of them were vacant positions, which you want, right? You don't want to assume that because a vision's vacant, you're not going to fill it next year. Some of them were some kind of technical things related to Social Security. Police officers and firefighters do get one sort of payroll tax, but don't get another. There were some things about step increases. Remember, a step increase is, I know we have the police chief on the phone, a patrolman starts at step one and then goes to two and then to three and then to four and then to five. So the increase they get in their salary isn't just the bottom line 2% or 3% or whatever it is. It's two. They move up a ladder and the ladder itself also moves up. So when you take all those expenses and you add them in, it adds about $1.3 million to the budget. So the $1 million that we had to help us on the earned income tax side gets entirely erased by these extra expenses. Now, I don't know if there's been more reductions or changes on the expenditure side. Those are just the ones that we've noticed and tracked and shared with the city. But the net result is right now, or at least I guess as of about 8 days ago, the budget that we've seen has about a $3.4 million deficit, right? So it was $3 million when we talked, and it actually has gotten a little larger since then, but still kind of hovering around that same area, around that $3 million. So if you have a $5 million deficit this year, that's this number over here, and then we apply another 3.5, you still, in your budget in 2021, you're still above $22 million, right? 27.5 minus 3.5 is 24. But if we look beyond that, notice the deficit that's 3.4, it grows a little bit here. It actually shrinks, I think, because your pension costs go down. Yeah, they drop. You have something in the police pension fund that finally drops out. But it hovers around a substantial number, right? If this 3 to 4, I think you could ignore this number out here that's 4 years from now. But it kind of hangs in this area. That's still fairly substantial. Now Reading has always had structural deficits. I think that's probably, unfortunately, a way of life. You've always done better than your projections. Always before COVID-19. You know, we just talked about all the positive things that were in the 2019 audit. So don't look at this, and those like Jeff and Donna and Marcia have been through this enough where they know how to read these numbers, and maybe the rest of you do too. Don't look in this in despair. It's not a prediction of financial disaster. It's just showing us that, you know, some of the challenges that Reading has will remain, right? So the whole purpose of doing this wasn't just to hit you with a million numbers, but also to give you some sense of how the numbers interplay with each other, right? So up here, we have the real estate tax and the earned income tax. And when I've distilled this down, there's lots of numbers here, but really the only ones that we'll talk about moving around one thing or another are the ones in yellow tonight, right? So the first thing you have is down here on the expenditure side. These are your debt expenses as they are in the budget right now. Right now, you're working on a debt refinancing that Mike Vinn and Stevens and Lee is leading. According to the most recent numbers that I have, those numbers will switch, right? You will save about $2 million on your debt costs next year. So you could actually see if you look down here before the refunding, it's 11.2, and then it kind of hangs there. With the refunding, really nothing beyond 2021 changes. It stays almost exactly the same. Next year's debt costs will be $2 million less. And if I take $2 million out of your expenses, now your reliance on reserves, if we don't change anything else, and I know that's not going to happen, but just for the moment, if we don't change anything else, you see your reliance on reserves is less, and now you're above the $22 billion, at least through the end of next year. So, takeaway number one, debt refunding helps you, but it only helps you for 1 year, right? The way it's structured, the savings are all front-loaded, and that's fine. But it's not something that helps any kind of structural deficit. It's a one-shot deal, right? So that's the first thing. The second thing is the earned income tax. Right now, what you see here, and we could model this 100 different ways, but what we're showing you right now is the assumption that the earned income tax revenues bounce back to your pre-pandemic levels, which is about $21.7 million in 2023, right? I've seen a lot of different projections. Moody's did a meeting with state finance officials and said that jobs, not necessarily revenue, but jobs wouldn't come back until 2024 or 2025. I've seen Moody's has done geographic specific ones where they said they think they will come back in 2022, where they'll bounce back in 2 years. This is something you can play with, right? You can see these are the revenues before 2019. This is your drop. This is what the pandemic has cost you. That's what it's cost you in terms of dollars. If we wanted to switch it up and say, okay, assume something more optimistic than that, right? We flip that switch, and now it's better, right? So now your gap out here, it almost goes away entirely in 2023, but now it's better. Of course, you could also look at this and say the opposite, right? You could say, well, what if they don't come back till 2024, right? And so you can play around with the assumptions here. None of us can control when it actually comes back. It's just to give you a sense that that variable, probably more than anything else here, remains the really key one. When are people able to get back to work? When are people able to get back to the level of earnings that they had before? And you know, how fast does that happen? So that's the second key variable. The third one, and the one you're probably most interested in talking about, is the real estate tax, right? Because this is the tax rate question. This number right here, the 26,314, that's your revenues, including the 10% tax increase. So that's just as it was proposed on October 1st, right? So if I just take the debt refinancing and I do nothing else, if I say what we're going to do is just refinance debt, you still have this sizable hole out here after 2021. So if the concept was, well, let's refinance the debt and then we won't have to do a tax increase, that won't work, right? And the reason it doesn't work is mathematically two things. One, the refinancing isn't worth as much as the tax increase. So you're not actually trading two things of the same size. But even beyond that, the tax increases every year the debt refinancing is one. Now, what you could do, though, is play with this tax rate. I said play with it in terms of the model here and say, okay, what if I did something else? And I'm, you know, almost entirely just making up numbers here. So instead of 19,259, we did 18,759, and then maybe we take it up the following year, right? That gives you a sense of where the of how the deficit closes. But again, the one scenario that really doesn't work here is this one. Let's not do a tax increase at all. Because now your deficit's $6 million next year, and you can't fix that, right? You're not going to be able to fill a $6 million deficit in 1 year, even if we say, okay, but now let's assume EIT comes all the way back. Still doesn't work. You still have a $5 million deficit. So you need, whatever the size is, you need a tax increase this year, because it's the only thing that I've seen or heard so far that changes your finances beyond next year, right? Again, the debt refinancing doesn't do that. I saw there was some discussion of moving fund balance from the street paving fund. That also doesn't do that, right? That's really basically the same thing. It's a one-time fix for next year, and that's helpful for next year, but doesn't help you beyond that. The last thing I'll say, and then stop, and we can talk about this or answer questions or however you want to approach this, is to remind you how plan compliance is determined, right? So our real role as Act 47 coordinator is to say, okay, does the budget comply with the plan? You got a very long letter for me today, the punchline to which is yes, it does, right? It complies with the plan. But we had this discussion back when Pedro was here, and can have it again now. There's two ways of looking at the deficit, which means there's two ways of looking at the tax increase, right? Those two things are linked together. The first is, are you staying above $22 million at least this year and next year? And you see, I forget, but now I've changed so many things around here. Let me go back and change this back to what it is in the budget. Okay. The answer there for this particular case is, The answer in this particular case is yes, right? You're above $22 million next year. You're above $22 million 2022. If you do nothing else, you start to fall behind your structural deficit or your fund balance level in 2023. This isn't going to happen. You're not going to do nothing for the next 5 years. But so that part of the standard is easy. That's straightforward. Is number one higher than number two? The second one that's more subjective is what the law really requires is that you have the, quote, reasonable probability of balanced budgets into the future absent Act 47. Again, the standard isn't reasonable probability that you'll never have any deficits. That's just not going to happen. But at some point, if the hole gets too big out here, we couldn't look at the budget and say, well, it's a $6 million deficit in 2022. They'll figure that out, because that's just too big a hole for you to make up in 1 year. You haven't had to close a $6 million hole in 1 year since maybe the very first year of Act 47. So that's just too big a hole. So whatever you do this year, wherever you land on the tax increase or other things, it has to help close the deficit in 2022. Because that's the standard that the law has for getting you out of Act 47. And plus, that's just the financially prudent thing you want to do. You don't want to lean so heavily on one-time fixes that 12 months from now, when those one-time fixes are gone, all your options are bad ones. I think that's all that I have.
And so, Gordon, I'm sorry, go ahead, Jeff. Permission to speak?
Yeah, go ahead, Jamar, then I'll go.
Sorry. It's hard to figure out with Zoom. Gordon, there is one other long-term fix. It's not quite one time, and Lucine kind of referred to it a few minutes ago, and I'm sure Council President was headed there too. Once the treatment plant project is completed, which will most likely be next year, then the city will be able to renegotiate the annual sewer transfer payment.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah, so that's this line here.
Yeah.
$3 million.
Yeah, we've had a discussion before. I mean, that essentially is we're getting about, I don't know, 1.5% return on our sewer system.
Yeah, very little. Yeah.
So we certainly.
So that would be great. Yeah, that will help you.
So with things like that in mind, I'm looking, going to the earned income tax line. Can you pull that back up, Gordon? I'd love to be able to use this spreadsheet too in the next couple of weeks.
I will send it to you. You can do whatever you want.
All right, good.
Nothing proprietary. It's all Windows Excel. So do whatever you want.
I know 2021 we have earned income tax going down 12%, and we'll have a better benchmark December 1st, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
For 2022, what's that reduction of earned income tax? It's still looks like it's
awful. Oh, it is. Let me see 1 second here. Still pretty substantial. It might be too much, and it's just there's no particular magic to it. So it's 6%. All I'm doing is saying, okay, if the revenues bounce back by 2023, then I'm just splitting the difference, right? Half of it comes back in 2022. Half of it comes back in 2023.
Yeah. So we may have a little blending there.
Get
to our final property tax rate. I just think some room there as far as the bigger ticket item. And we'll know that better December 1st. And do you know the formula as it relates to where we came up with the 12%? What formula or what formulation was used there? Was that just based on the discussion with Berks EIT?
Nope, that's based on what you've seen to date. So I will show you one other spreadsheet here.
Jeff, the initial projection from Berks EIT was a 30% loss. And the 1st of September, it came down at 18% in actual. And then with the beginning of November numbers, we adjusted it down to, I think, 14%.
Yeah.
So it's just so we have an idea, because December 1st, this is going to be a guiding light for us, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
To how much we can blend 21, 22, and 23, and that will impact our property tax rate. And, with the understanding, if we have to make bigger bites, we'll have a better measurement next year. If we have to do a bigger bite in property tax, we can do it. So we have the ability to calibrate this thing in what are very abnormal times. So this is how the rate was calculated, or you didn't find that? No.
Nope. So if you're looking at a spreadsheet that has you should see total August, September, October. So we take Berks EIT's monthly results. They report them to us every month. We break them out by year, by fund, by payer, all that other stuff. And then we look at the trend. So August, September, October, that is your third quarter. That's the full third quarter.
I'm not sure.
So that is a...
Not opening up for
not coming up.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Hold on. All right, let me try this again. 1 second. How about now?
Yep, we got it.
Okay. And I'll make it a little bigger here. That's super tiny. So they report their numbers every month. August, September, October, that's your third quarter. The thing to remember here is this isn't linear, right? It's not August is April and September is May and October is June. August, September, October is May, June, July, or I'm sorry, April, May, June. So December will be whatever that would be. That would be July, August, September. So December will be important. Overall, again, countywide, Berks EIT has said 10%. If we take resident and non-resident together for you, it's 10%. But the non-residents aren't in the general fund anymore. So if we just look at residents, it's 14%. So all we're doing right now is saying, okay, it's 14% today, it's 14% tomorrow, it's 14% forever. But we could play with that too and say, well, maybe it goes to 14 to 10 to 10. I don't know. I'm making this up. To 8. And you could see how it rolls through to different projections.
Yeah.
So this is where the math part of this gives way to a little bit of art and, you know, what do you want to assume?
Yeah, so December 1st, we're going to really have to look at this spreadsheet with the new numbers. And then translate, stratify that out through 2022 and 23, and then and do the modeling with the real estate tax. With the right amount of hedge so that we know if we got into 2021 and we didn't realize what we project even here, if this thing takes on a new course or there's COVID-20, God willing.
Right.
But it'll give us the safest and, you know, not the most overreaching tax increase that we can do.
Yep.
Because as well as critical as the city budget is, so are the family budgets as well. So that's the
that's the
puzzle we're in. You know, the city's squeezed, yet so is everyone else. So we're really going to have to calibrate this. So this is great. You have that tool. That number will come out December 1st. We'll need to be able to regroup with you right around that time to use this. And Abe don't already do that with you. But
okie doke.
Whatever it takes. Those are my thoughts. Thank you.
Jeff, and I want to add to that. I think what's so important is the way that we were able to move towards our exit from Act 47 was because of the work that Gordon's put in to have us make decisions based on key information. And I know, and I refer back to this, when I first got on council, we were making decisions in a complete vacuum and we weren't able to make reformed ones. So we must use these spreadsheets and use the calculations to say, okay, if you do X, what's it going to look like? Not only, we aren't only budgeting for next year, we're budgeting moving forward. What's it going to be doing to play itself out so that we can be saying to our constituents, this is what is going to be impacting the city, because no one wants us to get into a situation where we're needing to make decisions that will not only hurt families, but will impact on our public safety services, our public work services, all the services that a municipality has to give to its constituents. So it's always a balancing act. How do we make that happen? And I think this is an excellent tool to help us make those decisions. And for those of you that are familiar with Excel, if Gordon can give us that, you might be able to do those exercises on your own time to be able to look at the options rather than just putting out numbers that you have it based on fact.
Yeah, I will send it around. You know, it is not super sophisticated, but you're welcome to do whatever you want with it. The other things that you can do here, you know, if you want to play with the growth rates for anything else, these just pretty much line up.
Right.
This little column here tells you what's in each one. So if you want to play with the, you can see the assumed salary increases are 3%. Why 3? Because that's where the exit plan ends. And again, I don't, the letter, if you read through it, will say the key thing to remember for this year's budget is, one, you don't have to solve this number right here, this 3.8. this year, right? That's the 2022 deficit. You don't have to fix that now. We'll see what happens over the next, you know, however many months with COVID-19 and whatever else. But you also don't want to just do something that helps you with this number and leaves you with a massive hole the next year. And that, I think, is it.
Thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions? Donna?
I just want to thank Gordon. These are always valuable exercises, using these numbers and just really showing us where we are, and also keeping in mind, as you said, that we're not doing just this year. We are looking ahead, because for many years, people didn't look ahead. And that's why we're in a position.
Mm-hmm.
So all this is very critical and very important.
Well, that's a good point, Donna. So for the, some of the newer members, you know, this is really the most critical part of our budget, is not just really fitting out 2021, but working on this 5-year map, you know, to make sure that what we're doing today, as Gordon pointed out, you know, the debt service, $2 million we got for the is not recurring revenue. So it only supports a little bit of the revenue for 2021. We need recurring revenue or recurring expense reductions to really continue to stabilize our long-term finances. And we have that $22 million general fund balance reserve threshold that we have to meet as part of our own fund balance policy and as part of the Act 47 plan. So the good thing is we've had more organization in numbers in the last 10 years than we've ever had, and we've had the ability to make these decisions. It used to be in budgets, we didn't even know what the numbers were real or not in a given year. So it was nearly impossible to do five-year planning. So this is, in this case, yeah, five-year planning beyond this year. So this is really where the financial success of the city happens, is not in the 2021 budget, but looking beyond, you know, for the next 4 years beyond that, to understand how things are going to be impacted. And there's a lot of what ifs in between. As Jamar pointed out, you know, we're soon coming to the end of the sewer fund consent decree, the sewer system consent decree. God rest our souls, you know. I'm surprised I could have been locked up on that whole thing. What was that? Peg Hutchinson. Yeah, Peg.
Yeah,
you got it. Peg Hutchinson, right. Good memory.
You're very lucky.
That almost cost me everything. But, you know, so we have a huge opportunity there. And there are other things. And Abe is going to bring a lot of, and the mayor are going to bring a lot of, you know, incentive ideas to the city and hopefully improve revenues across the stream. So a lot of stuff we can't necessarily project. So these are just baseline projections that we can work from and feel safely, as Marcia mentioned, that public safety and the key items that people rely on first in city government are upheld, because we got to be able to protect the citizens. We need good fire protection and good police protection first, so then everything else is ancillary. So, Gordon, thank you for this. We'll look forward to you in the first week of December, seeing you again, either in your attic or in your car.
I got a new car. Right. Office upgrade.
Well, you deserve it, Gordon.
Very nice.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone. We'll talk to you later.
Take care of yourself.
Yep.
Okay, so we're on the home stretch here for the budget tonight. We have just the debt service and the pension, some of which was sort of referenced in our previous presentations. So I'm going to turn it over to Jamar.
Thank you, Marcia. And building on that very astute comment for you, I will have to say that we don't have a lot to present tonight, because we have already covered pension when we discussed the MMO. I would just draw your attention to the budget spreadsheet or to your budget binder. We record a pension for each department and division in that department and division. So if you start with the mayor's office, it's going to be row 26, and that covers everyone in that unit, continuing on to finance, police, fire, the auditor's office. All of those pension payments are tracked in the department budget. So that's one on pension. And then two on debt service. Debt service is tracked under non-departmental miscellaneous. I believe that is tab... somewhere on the back. Yeah, that's going to be around tab 16. And then is where we record our debt service. And I don't have an update for you there, because the bond refi that we've been working through closes on this coming Thursday, the 19th. So I wrote to council body this afternoon, and I would again request permission to update you all on the debt service schedule next Monday after we do the closing on this Thursday with our bond advisor, Mike Vend, who you're all familiar with. That debt service, once we get our new debt amortization schedule, will get plugged into the budget. And then we will apply those savings in reducing the size of the property tax increase, as has been mentioned before. And with that, I open to any questions from council, the auditor's office, and anyone else.
Just
Jamar Chohani, just to clarify, did you say the debt service is tab 17 where it says non-departmental miscellaneous?
Yes.
Okay. What is Main Street Initiatives? Because I see there's $60,000 allocated there.
Can you just give me 1.5 seconds, please?
Mm-hmm.
The short answer is I have no idea. The long answer is if you give me 24 hours, I can find out and email you directly and copy everyone on council.
There used to be a Main Street board that preceded the partnership. Would that be mislabeled, or is that the amount that goes to the Penn Street partnership?
I'm open.
Oh, is that the P3 contribution?
That's what I'm wondering because it used to.
The P3 contribution comes out of the DID contributions. 100,000 is for DID, 66,000 is for the P3.
So why would this even exist anymore, this Main Street? Because that was all sort of pulled together.
I am pulling up the general ledger right now to see what I can pull up on that.
John, yes, good point. Yeah. Very good point.
Thank you. And also, as it relates to the DID, I mean, I remember in the last meeting we had, they were requesting $250,000 from the city. I don't know that was agreed to, but if so, I don't see it reflected on here.
Hmm? Yeah. Would the Main Street go right into DID, because DID took over the Main Street's programs?
I don't think we have the answer to that. I'm wondering whether we want to give Jamar the chance to be able to research that out.
I'm just trying to ask how that happened.
Yeah, because
and also one other thing, I see business privilege license 2.5%. What is that? Because I thought we collect that. Isn't that a revenue versus an expense? I'm a little confused there.
Hold on 1 second, please.
Well, I think you could say that, Johanny, for a lot of those that are listed there, not only that one, as far as what those actual line items mean.
I think that's the commission that you pay for those collections.
Yeah.
And by all means, Jamar, take your time. I mean, I'm sure, you know, like I just have questions on these items, but if you need time to gather the data, it's fine. We can give you 24, 48 hours, whatever you need.
And so, I can please go into the questions that, remember, I'd asked council to put things in writing so that we have all the central place to go to get the answers. My concern is, and I have to be upfront with you, is we ask these questions, we get email back and forth, and we never have the full picture of all our questions and answers. So if you wouldn't mind, and I think Linda has the questions down, that we have a central place that we go to for all these Q&As. Yeah, Jamar.
I totally support what you said. I have some information, but I'd rather not just blurt that out in this meeting.
Sure.
Yeah, that's better, because some of them are a little more complicated to explain. Not that we're trying not to have anything be transparent, it's just they aren't real simple answers. But I am concerned about the Main Street. Are there anything?
And also, if I may, I did request via email a couple of times now information regarding that $66,000, like the expenditures report and things of the sort for that. And I haven't received anything. I don't know if it's because we really don't know, but if there's a way of figuring out how we're spending that money and what we're getting in return, that'd be great to know as well.
What's the 66,000? Which one?
Part of the P3 that it's part of the DID. I think 166,000. It says under Reading DID 166,150, but I believe that only 100 goes to DID and 66,000 goes to P3 or something of the sort.
Yes.
Yeah, it's good to have that breakdown. And I agree about the written questions. The problem is these emails just keep coming and coming and coming.
This is why I want to clarify the process. The emails, when you start getting a chain of emails, and that's the way we've been handling them, you can never find the information. What I would rather see is a complete list of Q&As, not being part of an email chain, but being a separate document that we can go back and reference and say, I asked this question on a certain date. This is what the response is, and that we have all of them lined up together rather than trying to, it's impossible to go through an email thread and get the responses. That's the way that normally government agencies work when they're doing Q&As around budgets and other items. So I think Jamar knows exactly what I'm speaking of, and if we could just compile those.
And if I can receive them, because I have not been receiving these questions.
Yeah, so they're to be directed to Linda and copy to Jamar. Would that work, Jamar?
Yes, because I'm not on the council distribution email, so I don't get all of those, right. All those threads you're referring to. I don't get any of that.
Yeah. So what happens is if we send a question and Jamar doesn't get it, then we might not get the answer if it's not going to the right place.
We haven't received any questions in writing for a few weeks.
Okay. And Linda, if you hear of any questions during these meetings, could you put them down in writing just so we'd have them on the continuous list? Would that be possible?
I'll try.
Okay. I know it's just a lot, but it's for our responsibility to get them in writing.
Right.
What's up? Oh, okay.
So, Marcia?
Yeah.
Just a point of clarity, too, because I want to make sure that the list of questions that I have are going to all parties that need to see them. So at this point, if I have a question, am I sending it to you? And then are you distributing it? Am I sending it to Linda? Am I sending it to the council distribution? Please just clarify where the list should be sent, the list of questions.
Right. This is where I think it makes it more sense, is it can go to Linda, myself, and Jamar. If council president or vice president want to be copied on it, okay, and they will be questions, which then we will have an update on those at every budget meeting that we have moving forward, because we're getting towards the end of the process. My concern is if you send it out to the whole distribution list, the questions aren't answered, then what happens is people start responding to them. I would rather have an update of all the questions that have been asked so other council members know what they are on a weekly basis. Does that sound like it works for you guys? I'm just trying to avoid the whole email chain where things are answered via the email chain and aren't in a central place to be answered.
I agree, Marcia, and I really appreciate your efforts here. I've had, you know, private conversations with Jamar. I've had private conversations, you know, with others, and, you know, just again, like making sure that we're streamlining the communications, you know, because things get lost, you know, in conversation. And if you're not doing it at a public meeting, if it's not on public record, you know, then are we getting those answers? And they're all valid and valuable questions that need to be answered.
And the other part is we might all have similar questions. So, for instance, one of us might want something that's linked to another. Then when the question is answered, it can be referenced back to if it had been previously answered. So that helps the administration to streamline their responses.
I think I'm ready to answer, actually.
Okay. But again, we want it in writing then, Jamar, but thanks.
Totally understand. I just did a quick little dumpster dive. So the P3 was created towards the end of 2018. In 2018, a line item was created for that amount of $60,000. That's the one that says Main Street costs. For the 2020 budget year, that item is being recorded twice. And thank you, Councilor Cepeda Freitas, we will fix this for 21. So the Main Street initiatives line needs to be zeroed out because that has been consolidated into the Reading DID line. So as I stated accurately, that 66.5 is for the P3 and the 100,000 is for DID. It's just been double recorded. And this alludes to some of the turnover, which is through no fault of anyone's own, but it's actually helpful that in my previous role, I was in those discussions. So I know that the timing of it is such that in 2018, when the P3 was instituted or set up, they put in a line for Main Street cost. And then starting this year, that Main Street cost line was folded in with the Reading DID line to do both of them. So we're going to zero that line out for 21.
Right, because when they disbanded the Main Street board, that money then went to DID to administrate what had been Main Street. I sat as liaison back in those days. Mm-hmm. So that's where that $60,000 went to the DID coffers.
And the importance of having this in writing is then we have some historical track of what's actually happened, because we have a lot of different, like Jamar said, a lot of different people handling this. So, and I'm sure there's other places where you're going to find those kind of inconsistencies that just need to be tightened up.
Which is why it's great to have so many different eyes on the same document, because we all see different things.
And thank you, Johanny.
In agreeing with the idea of everything being writing, sometimes when we're actually going over these things, that kind of give and take back and forth is when something like this comes up. So writing is best, but I just think the give and take is very important as well.
Oh, we need to have the dialogue. It's just a matter we have to then immortalize the dialogue by putting it in writing. That's what I want to see happen, and not having to put on Linda having to take down, because when it gets incorporated into minutes, you get it lost somewhere. So we're okay.
So it sounds like because we've had turnover, like we should probably be looking at line item by line item, and as we're looking at this entire budget before we approve anything.
Well, that's what we're doing through this process, Johanny. Is that's why we're going line item by line item.
Yeah, respectfully, I would submit that's what we've been doing for the last couple months.
Yeah. If that would be the case, we would just be able to have a couple meetings and just go right through it and approve it. We're allowing sufficient time, and we'll have time at the end to revisit anything where there's questions.
Because make no mistake, we have gone line by line with our department heads, our division managers, but there are still things that we miss. And for example, Gordon and Ashley on his team catch, and even tonight, Counselor Cepeda Freitas, you caught something that none of, like 10 of us caught. So, you know.
Yeah, I know, and I mean no disrespect, because obviously we work as a team, so it's a team effort, but I guess I'm thinking out loud, like, oh man, now we should probably make time to just keep looking, and like you said, Jamar, more eyes, just to make sure that, you know, we have and we approve what's expected for the new year, that's all.
Absolutely.
So thank you.
Good. Okay, any other questions? This has been very productive. And I really have to give everyone credit for really hanging in there, because between the audit, having the presentation by Gordon, and then diving down into some of this, everyone's been really staying on task. So great job. Okay, I don't see anything else. We are then ready to adjourn.
Just a reminder of the extra nominations committee meeting tomorrow to discuss the background policy.
Right.
And I would encourage as many of us that can attend, because that's really kind of been the holding, you know, for the nominations and for some of our commissions, boards and appointments like the Youth Commission. So if we can all join in efforts tomorrow to kind of try to see some movement there, that would be very appreciated. Thanks, Linda, for that reminder.
And I know this isn't a regular council meeting, but I'm going to add just with a council comment, just to remind folks, you'll see it posted on Pagoda Facebook, City Facebook, and Pagoda Skyline. We are having the gift shop from Pagoda Skyline open on Saturday from 12 to 3. We will not be able to go into the building. It will be a sidewalk sale following all the appropriate protocol. But if you're looking for city type gifts to purchase, please join us. When our understanding is from our weather forecaster, it's going to be 60 degrees and clear on that day. So we should have a lot of fun, again, observing all the proper rules. Thank you. Okay. I think we're ready to tune out then, or say good evening.
I hope everyone has a good night. That this meeting adjourned.
Yeah, this meeting's adjourned.
Time. All right. See y'all.
Bye, everybody.
Tomorrow.
Thank you.
Bye.
All.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.